Hello everyone, welcome. As usual, we will wait a bit for waiting for people to connect, and as soon as the number of attendees will stabilize, we will start. I think we are okay to start. At least we will present the team and the schedule. So welcome everyone. Etienne and me will present some new resources and some resources that have been updated recently on the code library. To start, we will go through a new version of page templates that we updated recently. So, talking about the dashboards, the data stories, and the observatory, we will see what's new in the in these templates. Then I will then Etienne will present you two recent resources to highlight your data catalog and to also monitor your portal. It will be a resource on the monitoring logs of your portal. And to finish, I will present a new resource in the theme section to customize the header of your portal to have a drop-down menu. And we'll see why it can be pretty useful in some case. So let's go. Yeah, I will share my screen and it should be okay. So recently we updated several page templates on the code library. Some of you probably already know these templates. So we have the dashboard here. To present KPIs and charts through a grid like this. We have the data stories that has been revamped also. And finally, the observatory. So recently at OpenDataSoft, we have a new person in the product team called Cécile. She is a UX designer and she helped us to adapt and to modify, to improve our templates by giving us some nice design tips regarding the blocks, the data, the content, the size of the fonts. Especially for this resource, we moved the filters here. We have now a sticky menu on the top that follows during the navigation in the page. So you always have your filters accessible. You can refine on one a filter of your data, and it will filter your page, and you will see the data moving and changing, and you will still be able to scroll through your page with your filters. We also improved the structure of the templates. The layout, in fact, the HTML structure is much simpler. You will need less CSS to customize your page to fit to adapt with your own content. And especially regarding the size of the elements, they will fit automatically your charts and your KPIs when you will modify the content, the title, the description, etc. Because in the previous version, it was a bit tricky sometimes if the elements inside the cards, the boxes, were different from the one in the template. Now it's much more simpler to reuse. Now I will let Etienne make a demo about on the domain datasets and the monitoring dashboard.
Yes, so we will present two resources that are more geared toward presenting your and monitoring your domain rather than presenting data to your audience. So the first one is the domain datasets. It's a presentation which uses a special datasets that you have access to, as described in the user guide, where you have to input domain datasets as the URL. So instead of HTTPS, you input this one. So let's go to a domain and see how it works. You go to your back office and then you add a dataset. You add a source. Okay, and then this is where you will input the special URL for your dataset. So you should have right here a lot of information about your dataset, the titles, the descriptions, terms, all sorts of things. We will add the private, the stage, datasets, sorry, and the custom metadata as specified on the resource. You also need to configure a few fields as facets. So once you are done with that, you will add it. I won't add it right now to the domain because we already have it on this specific domain, so I will just show you the end result. Domain dataset. Here we go. So we have our catalog view here. So if you look at the processing pipeline, so you have the fields as precise in the example set as facet, and you have one required processor. That is just, it's a simple replace text on the publishing properties field that just replace an empty value with manual. That is everything that is not scheduled or automated will fit into the manual category. Then you go to your visualization tab and you select the custom view. So once you enable the custom view, you go and copy your HTML and CSS code, okay, right here. And once you have inputted that, you will have to save and publish, and then you can go explore this custom view. So you will have your usual table and analyze view, but you will also have a custom HTML view with the number of private data sets, public, how they are updated, which one were last modified, which ones are popular, etc. This page is best viewed as a private page, most likely, although some information could be useful for a public page. You have a slight risk of having, for example, the name of private data sets displayed right here. Also, there is no very private information here, so this could be public as well. If you go public, just double check before that. The second resource we are gonna explore, this one is a page and is related to the monitoring data sets. So the domain data set is for monitoring your data set, and the monitoring one, so the monitoring source, is for monitoring all the actions on your portal. That is all the API calls, the number of exports, the which user make the most calls, what are the most frequent queries. This one is very important here. These are the text searches leading to no results. So right now we have none, but you can have right here if people often search for certain things and can't find it, this will appear just right here, and you can see from where are the API call if you want to see what you have here. As you can see, we have a very fancy sticky filter over here. We will go more about that later, but we will just use it so you can see that you can refine by data set, or you can select a more tight another time frame if you want to. So right now the example you are seeing is from an anonymized copy of a real one. Your monitoring dataset is absolutely private and should remain so, because you have all the information about your user making calls, including their username and IP. So this page should remain private at all costs. To access these data sets, you have to set the ODS API monitoring as the data set and monitoring as the source. It is available on all the domains by default, and it's documented also, not necessarily shown in the most wide audience path and tutorial path. But it's available here. You can filter on different fields if you want to. So we will try to edit the thing on CodePen by clicking the button as usual. Right here, let's make this one a bit larger. So right here, if you want to change on which facets we are filtering, we could, for example, say we want to filter on the user ID, and say, okay, we want to filter on the user right here, and then we have to refine our dataset, not on the dataset ID, but on the user ID. And then the option for your ODS select right here remain the one from your facet results named item. And as you can see right now, we can filter by user. So for example here, Lisa Simpson is not a good one. Let's make, so this is the monitoring from the portal of the CSM. So I have anonymized their names with characters from the Simpsons. So I leave it to you to find who is who on the characters. And then if you want to add another filter, then you have to select the whole filter div over here. You can just copy and duplicate this block, and then we want to add the dataset as well. So we are back to saying datasets right here, and we are back to say refine me on the dataset. And right here, as you can see on the results, you can filter on both the user and the datasets. Okay, I must have forgotten one of the fields, but you get the idea. So as you can see, these components are pretty cool, even for other usage than the monitoring dashboard. So we have extracted, especially we realized that people really liked this sticky filter over here. So we have extracted the cards with the charts and the sticky filter into their own components. That you can use on any dashboard you want. So they are called material themed cards. That is because they are following the design systems called material design. It's made by Google, and we will go into more details on how to use it, but you can visit the site should you want to have more information about it. So these are more stylized versions of the cards you saw. So as you can see right here, these are very minimal graphs, stripped out of all things like axis, grid, label, etc. for being very slick and deliver quick information. For example, this graph right here, the first one is really made to show a tendency. Is it going up, down, or does it make, but not necessarily to have the most precise counts of the most precise display of the data. As such, don't forget to replace the legend and the labels by your subtitles right here, else your user will be left a bit confused. So these cards can be customed just by changing a few CSS variables, and we will see how. So they are heavily custom with CSS, so not all options will be available straightforward. As you can see, we make a lot of modifications here on the widgets, so some options might not render really well. So if your case doesn't exactly fit what is presented in this resource, then maybe it's better to go back to a more simple and straightforward use of a chart inside a card, like we presented on the monitoring one. But if it fits your case, then you can customize the color. You don't have to worry about any of the CSS below. You go and just change the value of the color right here, and you have cards themed differently. Okay, all the component is the change. Okay, so right here the colors are presented in what we call HSL for hue, saturation, and lightness. This is a system very akin to RGB, except it's a different way of combining things. So as you can see, any color can be displayed as X, RGB, or HSL. Okay, so if you have a color in X, you can transform it into HSL. For example, using this tool from colordesigner.io or any other tool you find on the internet, there are a lot. You just have to type X to HSL, and if you have your X value here, you will have your HSL right here. So then we will have to input the H over here, the S over here, and the L over here. And then we will see how to use the next four variables. So why are we doing that? That is, so this way we can create a color gradient automatically, like the one you see here. So we have also customized the bar chart and the pie chart, so that is, they are very minimal in render. So let's say we want to add them to our example. What we have to do is only to copy the section right here, which will define a row, and then we will just paste this row below the other one. Okay. So let's paste the whole section. We copy that, and then we will have, so just below the section right here. Here we go. And we should have, let's make this thing pretty as well, format HTML. This is a pretty useful functionality of CodePen. And as you can see, we have our bar chart and then the whole pie chart, which is adapted to our color scheme, okay? Notice that in the example, the primary color was orange, and then we have the gradient over here. And now the primary color is blue, and the gradient is automatically applied. As you can see on the example, you can also change the background of your card and the text of the card just by just with the surface and card text variable. So let's try this one in our CSS to see how it looks. Sorry, we have to change this one too. Here we go. Okay, and maybe try to apply this orange thing as well. So we change the primary as well. Also, this one doesn't look too bad either. But let's go back. And as you can see, the other cards also change in color with that. So right here, we have changed the surface and the color text of the cards. We can also change the background, for example, if you want to make some sort of a dark theme. As we can see in the last example here, we have the dark theme. So let's see the code over here and try to pick the variables we have here. Oops. And try this one. Okay, should be good. And we have a dark theme. Good. And we still have the gradient over here. Okay. So the last component, we still have two more components. One is the data table over here. So it's a data table that will fit the width of the card with a highlight if you want. You can easily add a link on data if should you want to. And then we have the sticky filter we have seen. Okay, so this is the same one we saw on the monitoring data set that you can copy and paste to your dashboard. So to do so, you will select the whole nav element right here. Okay, it's called nav with a menu class, and we will paste this one right here. Okay, and it has to fit inside the container of your app. Okay, so right here we have a container. It has to be inside for the app to know that it has to be sticky at the top of the container. So right now we only have the HTML part, okay, but it sticks at the top. And we need to add the CSS parts right here. So let's copy the CSS, the full CSS of all the components, and it should be good. Okay. And we should have right here our sticky filter. So we almost have our monitoring the dashboard, but now you can theme it with your own color theme, just with a few variables in CSS. One last thing you may want to do is to display different colors on the color scheme on different lines. This is especially good when you want to have some color theme more like as info, as danger, for example. Right here, we made a red color to indicate that this requires some attention, or maybe something more successful to say it, to make it look like it's a good thing. So to do so, you can define multiple sets of variables. So just as we have defined it on the root of our application a color theme, we can add a color theme to a class. So if you have isInfo for something more blue, isSuccess for something more green, and isWarning for something more red. Then inside our HTML, we will find the sections, okay, and say this row. So this section is a row, but it is also info. So we have the isInfo class. Okay. And now this one looks blue. Okay. And if we want this one to be a success class, we find the next section and the next row, and we say isSuccess. Okay. And it should be green. Here you go. Okay, so if you look at the example on the code library, you will see that we have rebuilt the world the same dashboard as the monitoring, but with those themeable cards, so that you can apply a color scheme on that. Oh, for the sticky filter on mobile, so you can see if I make the screen smaller, it's responsive and it will stick at the top, okay, in a lighter, in a relatively small area. So I cannot, yes, I can. Let's see how it looks when it's really small. So you have to make it a bit bigger right here, but you can see right here that it will stick, and then you can just pick whatever you want, and then the display automatically switches to column one. So it won't be that good if you have many fields over here. Let's say you have 5 or 6 fields, it will start to look very large. So you should probably hide it and make a button to make it appear. If you have trouble doing that, please ask us and we will help you to achieve this effect. But if you have only one filter, switching to the column display with full width is enough from our test. And that's it on the themeable dashboards. Do we have any other questions? I don't think so. Yeah. No. Okay, so then Fred will present you back a very cool drop-down menu.
Thanks. I'm showing my screen. And it should be good. Okay. Yeah, so to finish, in the portal themes section, along the different themes that are already available, you will have a new resource called a drop-down menu. So a drop-down menu is the ability to gather, to group several items into one submenu like this. And it's pretty convenient when you have a lot of items, and especially when you want to gather them depending on the usage of the items behind. So, for example, I will show you on my personal domain. I gathered different elements depending on if they were user client side. It means if you want to gather all the elements regarding the data visualization here, I put the map builder, the chart builder. If you want to highlight your reuses, any pages that describe the portal, what you can do with data, the license, whatever. So you can gather elements like that. And you have two different way of opening this drop-down menu by click, like this one. Here you have with the standard, the default open data source portal header, and in this second example, you have with one of the theme of the code library. And the second way is by hovering with your mouse, just hovering like this. So this is also pretty nice. You can pick the one you like. There is no advantage or disadvantage of one solution against another. It's just that when you will have this header on, when you navigate with a mobile, the hover strategy will expand, will open it automatically, as hovering something, an element with a mobile is not possible. You need to click on it. So hovering menu is already expanded, while the other one with the click strategy is, like for the desktop view, is closed by default, and you can open it or close it like you want. Okay. One thing to mention is If you go with this kind of advanced resource, if you customize your portal header, you will bypass the header feature in your back office. So in your back office, you can already modify the header by setting the list of items you want by specifying the label and the link behind. If you customize your header, you will recreate on your own the header. You will recreate the structures, your HTML. So you recreate it by just copying, like all code library resources, by copying the header and the side sheet into your portal theme, but you won't be able to add it manually like before. So you will, for example, take this block, that is the tools sections, and you will have in your drop-down menu two items, the map builder and the chart builder. And you will simply need to take these blocks, duplicate them depending on the number of items you want to add. So it's one thing you need to consider if you go with this kind of advanced resources. I'm just checking the questions. No question for the moment. So do not hesitate if you have remarks or questions or ideas of improvement of these resources. And in the meantime, I will just present you, take 1 minute to present you the last resource that has been deployed recently. It's in the widget tricks section called ODS results, by the name of the widget itself. It's a really simple resource to give an example of what we can do with this resource. So ODS results is a basic widget that lists results from a data set. So results are records. So it's a way to list the records of a context. And you can just output the list of records as a list, as an HTML list like this, for example. So if we look at the code, it's pretty simple. It's just an ODS results. And for each records, you display a list item. Fine. You can also output it as cards. It can be nice. Often when you want to list records, you will need a pagination block to go over pages when you have lots of items. And finally, a full example, a nice looking example of this results, but this time with a combination with other widgets. So for example, with ODS record image, we go get the image of the record to display it at the top of the card. We display the title, the description, some metadata, etc. And we also use ODS geo tooltip to display the coordinates on the map while I'm hovering with my mouse. It just adds a little window to display the neighborhood of the location of my record. It can be pretty nice, and in combination still with the pagination block, it's pretty nice to use to display your content like that. ODS results is commonly used in several code library resources, maybe without even knowing it. For example, the listing generators, the table module, the search module. So it's a pretty powerful, basic but powerful widget. Still no question. I think we are good. The last word, for example, for the if you didn't notice yet, the code library has a RSS feed to subscribe and get notification or emails when there is new resources published. So do not hesitate to subscribe. You can click on the little icon here, and with your favorite news reader in your browser or any dedicated software, you can subscribe. If there is no more questions, I think we are good. I'm just checking the chat and questions. I think we are good.
I think we're good on questions.
Thanks a lot, everyone. And
thank you.
Wish you a nice day and, or evening, depending on where you are. And see you.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Oh, the question about the pie chart. Is there a way to remove all labels? Yes, you just set the display label to none. You set display values to none.
So all the labels. If you are talking about the values on the chart like this, there is an option to, like it says, display values to false. If it's the labels like the axis, you can with some CSS, yes, like Etienne presented.
I think she means in the themeable cards we still have the first and last value over here. So if you set the display values to false, they will go. But be sure that if you do that, there is no way for the user to know the scale and to have an idea of the value at a glance. So that's why we have the two versions: one with the first and last value, and one with the min and max as grid and as your grid line. But you can remove them, yes, just by setting the display values to false.
Values to false, yeah. Like in the second chart, in fact.
Perfect. Okay, perfect. Well, thank you very much and have a good day. Bye bye.
Bye bye.